You just got owned. Now, I'm a millennial. Boo, boo, millennials, boo. Y'all can kiss it. Millennials are awesome. We're the best of both worlds. We are the bridge between the 80s and 70s coming into the new millennium. That's why they call us millennials. We're the bridge between the baby boomers of Generation X and this craziness we deal with now. We are not this craziness. We just bridge it. We bridge the good. So don't blame us. We just made it possible for you to get them saved in Jesus' name. Amen. But when I was in school, which, by the way, tell y'all my age, the end of July is going to be my 20th reunion. That happened fast. That happened fast. I said, are y'all kidding me? We're already there? 20? Yeah. Oh, yeah, we are. So back when I was a high schooler, that was a terminology that was real. Man, they owned you. You just got owned, bro. So I don't know how many of y'all are used to that, but I'm used to it. So anybody else grow up using that terminology? Anybody ever use that slang? Yes, I got a few. I need help from my millennial folks. Now, don't leave me here to thank you. Put them up high. Show them where you are. Show them where you go. Raise it up high. Yeah. All right. Cool. Today's message, you just got owned. Look at your neighbor and say, you just got owned. You just got owned. What we meant by this is when you got in either a debate or argument and they just came up with something that was undeniable and it kind of shut down your argument, or you were trying to flirt with a girl and she kind of just shut you down in front of everybody and kind of broke your heart and ruined your reputation. You thought you was a Mac Daddy player and she just proved everybody that you really wasn't. You just got on, bro. That kind of deal, right? So today's message, you just got on. And here's the premise. That's not my premise. It just kind of is wordplay. The premise today is we think we own stuff. We actually think that we own the things that we own. We think it's possible for us to have ownership. But in reality, that is a myth. It is a myth that we can own something, but we buy the myth because we buy something that we then own what we have bought. Because I purchased it, because I paid for it, I now own this thing. I own this car, I own this boat, I own this house, I own this, what's the word I'm looking for? Something where you use a vacation on time and you don't get but 1 week. Timeshare. You know doggone well you don't own that timeshare. Come on, somebody. That's the bad one. That's the wicked one, right? Not realizing that what we have actually bought is a lie. We fail to recognize that the object that we just bought is what made us work so hard to begin with in order for us to be able to buy the thing. So in reality, we don't own it. It owns us. Anybody with me? Anybody? You can already see here, right? You don't own the house. The house owns you. You don't own the car. The car owns you. Matter of fact, see if you can get out of that car. See if you can go buy a new one. No, you got to get out of that one first. And here's the thing. You think you own it, but here's what's happened. Since you drove it off the lot, you now owe more than it's worth. It owns you. Come on, somebody. Y'all better... We fail to realize that the thing that we own is what drove us to work so hard and do everything we did to get this point. So in reality, it owns us. Not only that, but say I worked so hard to buy a house. My life was, I bought the American dream. I wanted the house with the white picket fence, right? The nice barbecue in the backyard. Come on, everybody wants that. Everybody wants it. Right now, we want it so bad in Savannah, you can't find one. You can't find it. But here's the problem. Say you buy that house, your name, you sign the dotted line. It's your home. You own it. Matter of fact, here's the proof that you own it. You pay property tax on it. But if the government ever decided that they wanted that land, there is nothing you can do to stop them from seizing it. You feel me? You bought it, you signed the dotted line, you pay your property taxes on it, but if the U.S. government decided tomorrow, you know what, we want that land, we're going to put a lab there, there's nothing, you can go to court, wouldn't matter. They can take it, now they'll give you a nice little check, whatever, but you don't own it. The government owns it. They can take whatever they want. Come on, somebody. There's nothing you can do to stop, so in reality, they own it. So it's funny to me how we buy the myth of ownership. Let's read this word today. We're going to be in the book of Judges, chapter 2. starting with verse 7. I'm going to read out of the New King James Version. You can read whatever version you are most accustomed to on your phone or whatever Bible you have. So the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord which he had done for Israel. Now Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died when he was 110 years old. And they buried him within the border of his inheritance at Timnath-Heres in the mountains of Ephraim on the north side of Mount Gash. When all that generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work which he had done for Israel. After that generation who God had done the miracles, signs, and wonders, he brought them and gave them the promised land. When Joshua and all the elders, when that generation had been laid to rest, there arose another generation who knew not the Lord nor the works which we had done, which he had done. I'm not going to stop this in my message, but boy, it feels like America today. It feels like our country today. I'm being real with you. It bothers me. It breaks my heart. Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord because they didn't remember him. The children of Israel, the ones who had been so blessed, the recipients of God's favor and miracles, they did evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers who had brought them out of the land of Egypt, and they followed other gods from among the gods of the people who were all around them, and they bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. Now, let me tell you something. Here's why we fail sometimes. We realize we think God's being harsh when he says, when you get there, drive everybody out. Drive them out. Drive what the residue. Don't leave them around. Drive them completely and utterly. And when they fail to do so, God says, that's going to come back and bite you. Boop, exhibit A. You remembered God, but the generation after you didn't know God. So now they have been, because we never drove it out, now they are witnessing and being and seeing and taking a part of the things that God told us to drive out, but we never did. And now those same things that God gave us victory over now have deceived our families and our generation after us, and they have victory over them. They forsook the Lord. He says it again. It's so important he says it again. They forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Ashtoreths. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. So he delivered them into the hands of plunderers who despoiled them. And he sold them into the hands of their enemies all around so that they could no longer stand before their enemies. Wherever they went out, the hand of the Lord was against them for calamity, as the Lord had said and as the Lord had sworn to them. And they were greatly distressed. He tells you that for a reason. God's allowing this to happen. God is letting calamity come because he swore to them this would happen if they did what they did. So God has no options. God is bound by his word. Which is why God can't bless sinfulness. He's bound by his word. He loves you. God wants to bless you. God wants you to be blessed and favored. God wants you to have success and achieve things. But if you're living in sin, God is bound by his word. He cannot bless it. So God's not the one to blame. Come on, somebody. Wherever they went out, he was against them in their great distress. Verse 16, nevertheless, the Lord raised up judges who delivered them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Yet they would not listen to their judges, but they played the harlot with other gods and bowed down to them. And they turned quickly from the way in which their fathers walked in, obeying the commandments of the Lord. They did not do so. So when the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge and delivered them out of the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For the Lord was moved with pity by their groaning because of those who oppressed them and harassed them. And it came to pass when the judge was dead that they reverted and behaved more corruptly than their fathers by following other gods to serve them and bow down to them. They did not cease from their own doings nor from their stubborn way. God bless reading of his word. Help it be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. See, you should have watched Wednesday because Wednesday piggybacked off of Sunday, and this message piggybacks off of Wednesday. You see, there's some continuity in how things flow. This is God's the one putting this all together, and I'm so grateful. As we talked about authority last week, absolute authority, and I followed it and went into greater detail Wednesday. that in order for us to stand on the authority of the word, we must be submitted to the authority of the word. If we're not submitted to the authority of the word, I don't care how much you quote it, you're not going to have authority with it when you yourself are not submitted to the authority of the word itself. You understand? So we are submissive either to the word of God or to sin, one of the two. And I'm not talking about a singular act of sin, but I'm talking about practicing sin. Matter of fact, we're told this, he who practices sin is not of God, point blank. That's Paul tells us plainly. When you're saved and born again, if you know the Lord, you don't go on sinning. So if you make a practice of sin, if you're a practice sin, then you don't know God. You may have thought you did, but you don't. And it bothers me that so many in the church today, we live lives that are not pleasing to God. We are bound by a sinful act. We are bound by a practicing habit or a habit of sin that we practice and engage in. And then we're upset and wondering why we don't have any authority or can't take authority, why the enemy is not under our feet, why we constantly have to deal with defeat and setbacks is because you're trying to invoke authority which you yourself cannot stand on because you've not submitted to it to begin with. Right? Jesus did not die and raise again, and God did not send the power of the Holy Spirit for his church to be defeated and powerless. And we're not, because here's the thing, the name of Jesus is not powerless. The power of the Spirit of God is not powerless. The problem is, whenever we do not stand under it, when we are not submitted to God, we don't have the authority to invoke the power of God. It's not that God is powerless. The problem is the church has become powerless. And sin is the problem. You know why? Because we have become owned. We're owned. See, God's people turn from him. It's a thing we read all throughout the word, and it happens today in our lives, not over and over again. God's people turn from him. They start off at the bottom. They're in slavery. They're literally owned, not just figuratively, not just spiritually. They're owned physically. God hears their groaning and cries. He sends Moses. He delivers them out of the land of Egypt, out from under Pharaoh. He takes them into the wilderness. And eventually, when they're finally ready to be obedient, he gives them the promised land that he had promised them. They go in and inhabit it and take it. And now they've got everything they've ever wanted and needed. But they forget about God. They turn from God. And now they're worshiping Baal. Can I tell you where this kind of struck me this week with this message I was reading through? Is I felt the unction of the Holy Spirit. I know it before and I've studied it before, but I felt like the Lord told me to look up Baal. And do you know what the word Baal means? The translation of Baal, this god they served? Owner. Owner. One who owns. So they left God and they started pursuing the owner. And the thing about the owner is, what I find weird is, it's all under the same name, Baal, which means owner. But depending on where you were in what region and how you worship Baal, Baal could take many different forms. So they were owned, but it depended on where they were and what was going on in their lives, depending on what they were owned by. I hope somebody gets this. I believe we are. I hope we are. Pastor, what are you saying? I'm telling you that in one part of the country where they were, Baal might have been represented by a bull. In another form, he might have been represented as a god who had a lightning bolt in his hand, kind of like Zeus. In another form, he may have looked like a hawk, a bird. In another form, he may have looked like... So what I'm telling you is they all called him Baal, owner, but they were who they served as their owner was different, had different forms based on who they were, right? So fast forward, what I'm talking about today, what I'm trying to tell you is what we fail to realize is we think that because Jesus died and rose again, because we come to church, we think that Baal is just some old myth of a spirit that has dead and gone that we don't deal with, when in reality, Baal is alive and well. Baal is alive and well in the church. Because if we're not careful, we will stop pursuing God and start pursuing things that we want to own, that in reality they now own us. Why? Because your time is dedicated to it, your energy is dedicated to it, your worship is dedicated to it, and in reality you are owned by whatever form it is. For some it's the house, for some it's the car, for some it's the booty call that they can't leave alone. Whatever the case may be, it ain't God that you're worshiping. It's some other owner that has ownership of you. It just depends on what form that it takes. For some it may be the job. Come on, my God. I'm trying to help us. God help us. And we think we own it, but it owns us. Think of this now. Go back. God help, Lord, help us connect this. God help me. They're in the promised land, but because they saw other people worshiping Baal, because they saw other people doing it, because they saw other people celebrating it, they got curious and said, well, maybe that would help me. Maybe that's what I need. Maybe that's what I want. It's because they saw somebody else with it that they had the desire for it. So they started pursuing it and worshiping it, and then they come under ownership of it. These Baals, they forsook God and they dedicated themselves to the worship of Baal, to the worship of idols. And there's a song that broke me down when I was about 21 years old. It's a song come out by, he's not a well-known artist by any means, but he's a singer named Ross King. And Ross King had a song, literally, the title of it was Worship is More Than a Song. And he said, because we can sing all we want to. Yes, we can sing all we want to. Yes, we can sing all we want to, but don't get me wrong, worship is more than a song. And then in the song, he says, anything that I put before my God is an idol. Anything that I want with all my heart is an idol. Anything that I give all my love is an idol. Anything that I can't stop thinking of is an idol. Anything that I give all my love is an idol. We must not worship something that's not even worth it. So clear the stage, make some space for the one who deserves it. And I was at a ministry retreat as I'm hearing that song, and every time he starts talking about anything that I can't stop thinking of. So one thing was symbolized by job, another was symbolized by money, another was symbolized by a house and all this. And so it really done a number on me. And the reality is that's what worship is. Whatever we're constantly thinking about, whatever we're constantly talking about, whatever we're constantly being driven to and working so hard for and putting energy and effort towards, in reality, just because we give it a different name doesn't mean that it's not an idol. And if we wake up and realize before we're getting all mad with me today, if we do a real self-assessment, we'll start realizing we got two or three or four idols in our lives that compete with our attention and love and that compete with God for our affection, if you will. And if we look at it really honest, there are things that we have let be established that we think that we own, that we think that we are in control over, but they have divided our worship and they stand between us and the presence of God, and they draw our attention and it draws our time and it draws our effort and it draws our energy to the point we'll work 40 hours a week and not open our Bible to pray for a single hour. You tell me which one has power over your life. You tell me which one are you worshiping? Are you worshiping God, or are we worshiping Baal in one of his many forms, and he owns us? It could be the job. It could be sex. It could be addictions. It could be material wealth, lust of the eyes. Anything could be an idol. Anything we crave, anything that we put on that pedestal, that's what Israel does. You understand? Anybody connect this? That's what they did. God set them free. They have all they need, but they're just not happy. They want more. I want what that person has. So if I got to work more to get it, I'm going to get it, and then I'm going to have it. And I think that I own it when I get it, I think I own it. I fail to realize it owns me. It owns me. And that's the place where the American church is. That's why we don't have authority, why we don't have power. We've got idols in our lives. We do. And here's what God does. God raised up judges. He raised up men and women of God. I think of Deborah. I think of Samson and all these other, God raised up judges that were faithful, that he would use, that would call the children of Israel back away from sin. They would get right with God. But then whenever that judge would pass away or die, then they'd go right back to it. Then God have to raise up another. They'd go right back to it. Then God would deliver them again. They'd go right back to it. God would do a miracle and they would go right back to it. God would do a sign or a wonder. He'd have their attention for a minute. They'd go right back to it. Pastor, what are you saying? It amazes me, the parallel of the church. When we see a sign, wonder, a miracle that the power of God puts on display for us, all of a sudden we're hot for God for a couple of weeks. We're reading our Bibles. We're praying for a couple of weeks. We're going to revival a couple of weeks. We alter our lives for a couple of weeks. But all of a sudden, as that high wears off, we find ourselves going right back to the same old nasty gods that he delivered us from, that own us again. We go right back in the prison place needing God to do another miracle. Woo! Well, when does it end? I'm so glad that you asked. See, God had a plan. He said, you know, me sending these judges of flesh and bone ain't really getting the job done in the long term. So what am I going to do? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to defeat this stronghold in the lives of my people because I'm going to send a method of redemption. That he's not just going to be judged, he's going to be lamb worthy to be slain. He's going to be the sacrifice. He's not just going to be one that preaches repentance and pulls them out. He's going to be the sacrificial lamb himself. He's going to be the sin offering. And I'm going to make a way where it doesn't matter what's going on in their lives, where I don't have to kick them out, where I don't have to punish them. I'm going to make a way that the door can stay open, that all they got to do is call upon the name of my son. I'm going to make a way that the blood is going to be shed, that it won't be a one-time forgiveness. It won't be a one-time offering. I'm going to make a way that even when they forget me, I shall not forget them. I'm going to make a way, even when they turn from me, I'm not going to turn from them. I'm going to make a way that when they're doing, I'm going to make a way that I can pursue them with my spirit. That I don't, my God, Pastor, what are you saying? I'm telling you, whenever they would fail in sin before, God would have to distance himself. And then when they got repentant, I send a judge to come. Here's what I love about the cross of Christ. The blood did a permanent work. The blood did it. I know it was blood. I know it was a blood. I know it was a blood for me. So when the blood was shed, my sin was forgiven to the point that even now when I might stray, even now when I forget about what he's done, he don't have to cut me off anymore. Now there is a way through the blood of Jesus, he can still grab hold of me and not let me go. Friend, you ought to be grateful for the blood, because if not for the blood, he would have let you go a long time ago. But there was a propitiation for your sin named Jesus, and God said, I'm gonna make a way where I ain't gotta let you go. He should have let us go a long time ago, if not for the blood. In closing, Pastor, what are you saying? I'm telling somebody here today that it's time to come back around. It's time to come back home. It's time to wash your face and get the sleep out of your eyes. It's time to wake up and realize that you have wandered to a place where you are dabbling in ownership, where you're dabbling in idol worship. And I believe God's trying to get a hold of somebody today and say, it's time to come out. I don't want you to go so far. I paid this price. I've made it possible for you. You ain't got to stay there. Let go of the temporal things that you're chasing. Why would you chase something temporary when I've given you something that is eternal? Why would you chase something that is earthly when I've given you something that is heavenly? Why would you try to satisfy your body when you can satisfy your soul? Don't you know the reason why you think you want it in your body is because your soul's not satisfied? Your soul's not satisfied because you've allowed sin to enter your camp and you're worshiping idols. But if you'll come back to the cross of Christ today and repent and let the blood fall on you again, your soul will be satisfied. My God, I ain't getting a witness today. My soul is satisfied. I don't crave, listen to me, I don't crave the things of the world because I'm so full on the inside. I've been satisfied in my spirit, and there ain't nothing else that I want in this world. Pastor, what are you saying? I know it might be hard to believe, but I'm not rooted and grounded in desiring the things of man. And it's not because I'm holy. It's not because I'm better than you. It's not because I'm so disciplined. It's not because I'm worthy. It's not because God called me to preach. That's not why. The reason why is when I got a hold of him, I didn't let go. The reason why is I realized that I'm dependent on him every day of my life. The reason why is because I tasted and seen that the Lord is good, and I realized there ain't nothing else in this world that I can partake that can match what I already got in my mouth. My God, why would I spit out a steak for an old burnt, crusty cheeseburger? I don't understand some people. My soul is satisfied. Therefore, I don't go pursuing the things of this life. That's why I don't pursue affairs. That's why I don't have wandering eyes, and women can't get, listen, you don't think they tried? They can't have me. I'm not attracted by it. I pity it, and I get kind of, oh my, here we go again. See, because most men are blind to this, and they just see with the lust of their eyes, they think, oh, she's hot. I'm thinking, this is a crazy thing right now. She crazier than a sprayed roach? She, no, not, don't want none of it. You crazy? You crazy, because you must be, because you're coming after me. You don't, you crazy as you can be. I ain't want nothing to do with you. Nope. Don't want it. Ain't interested. Go on somewhere. I'm telling you the truth. Oh, you just think you, no. But I'm so devoted to the Lord. Nothing else is even tempting. I've said this before. Nothing else is even tempting like that no more. And God would have it that we all can get to that place by saying, God, I want you more than Baal. I want you more than the house. I want you more than the job. I want you more than the dollar. God, I want you above all things. And if you'll pursue him like he's the most important thing in your life, friend, he said, when you seek me with your whole heart, you'll find me. When the problem is, we ain't sought him right. We seeking the dollar, we seeking the notoriety, we seeking the degree, we seeking the job title, we seeking the ministry, we seeking that love interest. But if you'll seek God, you'll find it. Let me tell you what happens when you seek the other stuff. When you seek the house, you'll find the house, but it'll leave you empty. When you seek the dollar, you'll find the money, but it'll leave you purposeless. I'm preaching to myself, and that's okay. You'll seek with your whole heart the love interest. When you find them, you realize they're crazy. So what you've done is you have fallen for the image of Baal. So now you're in a repetitive cycle of seeking nonstop, because you were buying the form, not realizing that you're owned, because you just got owned. But when you seek the Lord with your whole heart, he says, you will find me. And when you find him, you have found everything. Love, joy, peace, purpose, destiny, hope, security. There's no need for anything else, because everything that I've ever wanted, I found in the person of Jesus Christ. That's what God did. So today we find ourselves, and I said, I'm closing, and I am. Here we are. Today we find ourselves, what are we going to worship? Have we bought the myth of ownership? What owns us? What's taking up our time? What are we so passionate about, so enthralled over? If the answer is not Jesus, then friend, you just got owned. I'm not trying to judge you because it's our video, but again, we did put out a midweek thing. We talked about it last Sunday. We talked about it for 2 or 3 weeks. Coming out on Wednesday, and how many? 10 people in this building watched it? You have time to watch it on Wednesday or this week? You didn't check in? You know why? You didn't want to check in, because you don't care enough. You don't care enough to look. This is not an ego trip saying, you should look at our church's stuff. It's a fact. We don't care enough to look. God has to come stand in front of our face with blinking lights going, hey, man, because it's proven we're not seeking him. He's having to do a million just to get our ever-loving attention, because we are not seeking him. Well, I come to church. I don't care. I gave money to the offering. Take it back. It's the truth. We bought the lie because we came today, oh, I'm good. No, what you did is you sought an experience, not relationship. I'll say that again. You came and you got it. You had an experience, but you don't have a relationship. Isn't it crazy? God help me, Lord. I'm trying to close, y'all. I'm trying to make it so obvious, though. It's crazy that a man can be married to a wife and go to a strip club because he's more driven by experience than relationship. Same thing with pornography. Go ahead and get quiet, because the statistics tell me about 7 out of 10 of you deal with it. Married to a wife. I love her. Pastor, I love my wife. All right, give my... Okay. But you're driven by experience, not relationship. She's at home. What are you doing? Seek him and you'll find him. But the problem is we've convinced ourselves that we are seeking and we're not. The proof is in the pudding. Where's your time spent? Where's your energy spent? Where's that effort at? Don't nobody have a problem getting up and going to work. But Sunday rolls around, I'm just really tired. Don't have nobody have a problem turning on Netflix or YouTube. Pulling teeth. We don't realize we're owned. But he sent his son to break and destroy and to tear apart that contract. Even though we don't deserve it, he made a way for us to be free. He made a way for us to have salvation without paying for it ourselves. You want that? What a beautiful ownership. Hey, you can have this without paying a dime. It's just yours. All you got to do is take it. It won't cost you a thing. It cost him everything. Would you stand to your feet this morning with me?